Welcome back. This is the Intel on ENCA. Our conversation continues. Our profile interview with the Deputy Minister of Cooperative Governance and Traditional Affairs, Thembi Nkadimeng. Thembi, let's get straight to this issue then. It's a bit of a difficult and touchy subject because all those years later, you continue to grapple with it. In my introduction, it's actually the second thing that's mentioned about you, other than the position you occupy. To what extent has the legacy and the issue of Nokuthula Simelane shaped the person you've become?
I can say my sister is my propeller. I actually call her my ancestor. You know,
yeah.
Of course she is. But in a direct translation, that I do feel like any other person, when I'm just about to give up for whatever reason, and I just look at a picture in my bedroom and I'm like, she never did. She didn't quit. Even at most difficult circumstances that history has got to be explained about her, 23-year-old girl didn't break. So why should I? You know? Yeah. So I think she's my propeller. But to be honest with you, I cry about it until today. I laugh about it. I interact with people who were close to her. I underdo Pumla Williams, Mpumi Mpofu. My sister, by the way, disappeared when I was only 9 years old.
Yes.
So I got to learn from the friends. Umama Kaphumzile Van Dam, Ospings Masuku. They were in the same activity group politically in Swaziland. So I've troubled them all the time, looking for pictures, looking for stories. Who was she? How did she interpret life? Why did they join struggle, all of them, at that young age? Why was it important? Themba Madumo. So I cry their tears. When they meet me all the time, I think the first remark they go like, your eyes are so resembling of her eyes. And I'll go to the pictures and look for these eyes because I wouldn't have known and thought about it. But on another hand, I do get to feel that it has touched me less than how it had caused them pain. I mean, my brother is only a year apart from Nokuthula, and they were at the university together. And he used to explain to me with tears in his eyes that my father got to the University of Swaziland and said to him, where is your sister? And I knew it pained him that he never had an answer until my father's death. And he did all he could. Well, nothing could be forthcoming. But I've had more energy compared to all of them because I never really got to experience my sister. So in a way, I've been able to treat it like a story that I'm reading in a newspaper.
Yeah.
It hurts, it's painful, or a movie that is painful that I watch. I do get the connection with my sister, but it comes through others. When they cry, then I realize that this thing is painful. But I've been unable to shed my mom's tears,
yes,
you know, to wash them away, to console her, to do any other thing. I mean, every second day she calls me and says, when is the case coming? Do you think it will find me alive? I think that's the painful part.
It says to me then that your mother is quite ached by it all, even all these years later. And who can blame her?
Every day.
Because there are still no answers.
Every day. Every day. In fact, the saddest part about this position and many that I've occupied before, when my mom sees me on TV with President Ramaphosa and he says, can you ask him to send the police to look for my daughter? And she believes that because I've got close access to whoever that I talk to, that I seem to work with, I can divert them from their function and ask them to look for my daughter. She also believed that possibly they might have whispered to me how they've killed her and I'm afraid to tell her. So she'll always give me an assurance. If you know anything, no matter how painful you think it will be, just tell me. I'll make peace with it. And what? I don't know.
So what is the answer to that question that she always asks you? How far is the case? Because it's part of the conversation we were having just recently with the death of João Rodrigues.
Rodrigues.
Yes. Yeah. That some of the people who have these answers are dying off.
In my case, we were having 5 accused. I'm left with 3. Mm. 2 have passed. Khajabe, I think he was a police officer at the time. He must have passed away in 2018 or 2019, just shortly before COVID. And Brigadier Mong passed away now during, I think, the second wave of COVID. I'm not sure if his death was COVID-related, but it's just as recent. So I'm left with 3 of the accused out of the 5. And yet we don't, and every day I get to say witnesses I'm going to lose that are going to be able to shed the light. And it pains me to look in her eyes and tell her I do not have any knowledge. I mean, the case was supposed to come in August, on the 2nd and 3rd, this past August, and a week or so before you receive a letter from the NPA, we have agreed with the defendant's lawyers that can it be postponed to March. We're not ready with whatever form of investigation. So I think that's the greatest sense of betrayal that I also feel as a person, that my mom, my aunts, everybody else feels. But it is for me also to preach justice, but also to live by the weight of what justice means.
And the nice thing is that we don't have to worry about anything being said about, you know, you criticizing your own government, etc., because the NPA is a separate independent entity. They are supposed to be operating independently. Last week or the week before, I might be getting my dates confused, I had Shamila Batoi sitting where you are sitting, and I was asking her about these very matters to say, It's all very well to say at some point in the early 2000s, there seems to have been political interference where we now learn from people such as Vusi Pikoli and others coming through and saying, actually, there was an instruction that said, leave these matters alone, which is something that should not have happened. It's quite another to then see a situation where we're saying the NPA is resurgent, but these matters just simply don't move.
But also besides that, I mean, the Credit 4 case, for example, is getting reignited a bit faster, getting to the table. Nobody represents the family from a legal point of view. No one does gives a legal brief. Yet the NPA pays, or the state pays for the perpetrators because of the agreement that we've had. So for me, justice cannot only be about sitting in court. How is Mrs. Kalata going to move from the Eastern Cape to come to Pretoria High Court to be able to see justice being done? It may sound like a small thing, but it is a very important thing. Had we not have pro bono lawyers who are investigating on our behalf, representing us, it therefore means we'll have justice to be tilted on the basis of agreements which were made. I mean, we just got to hear that De Kock is being paid by the state about 40,000 a month. My mom lost her hearing. Nobody pays for her. You know, so I guess in some instances, a review of actually what the TRC recommended is what will be important to deal with justice in its entirety.
Yeah.
You know, to be able to care. I mean, Mrs. Koniwe just died now, the wife of Matthew Koniwe. I mean, what justice did she receive? What assistance with the children who were 3 years old, you know, for her to raise them, for her to take them to school, so that they are able to be the individuals in their capacity that they are supposed to be. So for me, justice is not only about looking for remains only. I think we've really been betrayed, you know, and it cuts deep.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah, it cuts deep.
In the little time that I have remaining, let me ask the team to also roll the pictures again as we draw to a close. There's a picture of a man there that I assume is your father.
Okay.
There must be, it will be coming up shortly. There must be a reason why you would send me that picture. He obviously was a significant influence in the person you became.
Yeah, a man of very few wits, but very sharp to the point, you know. You know, mothers will always go, you know, they will, you know.
Yes.
My father used to say one word and it will be enough. And when my father speaks, I will know that I've crossed the line. When my mother talks, yeah, I will take it. It's a mom, she must always fight. But we had a very strong bond. That's my father.
Yes.
That's the man who made who I am. Look, I had benefits because of the disappearance of Noctula, not in a bad way. We were four, two girls and two boys, and I'm the last one. So my father used to call me Ntomkulu, and I got everything I wanted, and literally everything I wanted. Even if I possibly would have said, go and rob a bank. I think he would have. But I had the greatest love, I had greatest care, I had greatest guidance. I remember starting in the northern province then, I had a case of sexual harassment in a first job that I had. And I decided, look, I'm going to fight this, but I'm also going to leave. And his words were, you're going to be a rolling stone. Fight. And in everything I've done, whether there's somebody who says doesn't want me to the mayor to be a mayor of Polokwane and I want to, I fight.
Sure.
So that was who he was.
Yeah.
He said, I fought to the bitter end. Noctula fought to the bitter end. You can't quit. We are not quitters.
Wow.
And every time I think about him, is that I must never quit. And I never will.
Wow. Thembi Nkadimeng, I'm so glad you came through and we've had this conversation. I'm completely out of time, but it's been quite illuminating and quite revealing, because the idea is that people should know the person you are. And then in future, of course, you and I will fight.
We'll fight about municipalities.
That's almost
I'm
guaranteed.
Looking forward to that one as well.
That's almost
I think
guaranteed.
I'm getting ready for my office a month down the line, but I've shaped up.
Thank you so much.
Next
Thanks
time.
For
Thank
coming.
You very much for having
Thembi Nkadimeng was our profile interview here on the Intel. Stick around.